So, welcome to this new session of the Zerin Continuous Learning. This time I'll talk about the MQTT protocol. So the presentation is organized in three main parts. The main part is the second one about the MQTT 3.1.1 version. But I'll start with a very brief introduction on what is a communication protocol and how these are managed in the IoT era. And finally, now as a concluding remark, I will go through the main new feature implemented in the MQTT version 5. So, communication protocols. From Wikipedia, communication protocol is defined as a system of rules that enable two entities to exchange information. And to properly communicate, so to properly exchange meaningful information, the entities should rely on a common set of rules, so they should reach an agreement. When it's needed to set standards for a communication protocol or for a standard in general, there are several standards organizations that manage all the processes of starting from gathering requirements and setting all these rules. And these to ease the process of defining of setting a standard document for a communication protocol, conceptual models of communication protocols comes in handy. The most common are the OSI model and the TCP/IP model, that are in fact conceptual models that rely on a stack of layers, of different layers, where each layer serves the layer that stays above and is served on the level that is below. So each of these layer cover aspects, different aspects of a communication system. So they start from the physical layer, which is the physical quantities that changes during the process of the communication, and up to the application layer. So what the users should read and write or speak and listen to for communicate. These conceptual models are just guidelines to help defining a communication protocol or to ease the explanation of how a communication protocol works. Very, very few examples. There are some communication protocols that define just the lower part of the OSI stack. For instance, this is the CAN, is the model of the CAN CAN bus communication protocol, and this standard defines just the physical layer and the data link layer. Other more complex protocols define, or more advanced protocols define also the layer above, but they may not define all of these layers. For instance, the J1939 protocols, that is the one used in some electric engines or engines equipment in general, they, for instance, rely on other standards. The physical and data link layer are exactly the same. They can protocol, but they also define a way of exchanging information among a network of entities, how the information is, let's say, transported across the network, and at the application level also how the data is should be encoded in the messages. OSI ISO model and TCP IP model are often used together. I mean, when defining a specification for a communication protocol, they are used. They can be used both. And for the application layer of the TCP model is kind of related obsession presentation application model of the OSI ISO model. For instance, TCP UDP rely here on the transport protocol, and SSL TLS, the one Giacomo talked about in the last session, stays in the presentation layer of the OSI model. But in the TCP IP model, it should rely on the stay on the application, but it's not just an application; it's a wrapper of the transport to allow other application to talk in a more secure way. So MQTT. MQTT is a client-server publish-subscribe messaging transport protocol. It is an open standard, is an OSIS and ISO standard. It's a lightweight and bandwidth efficient protocol. So this is why it's mostly used in IoT, also in constrained resources devices. It's also easy to implement, and it is data agnostic. Data agnostic means that this MQTT protocol defines how entities should exchange information, but the format and the content of the data being transferred isn't defined in the protocol. Here below you can see a very brief history of the MQTT. The first implementation was carried out in 1999 by a guy from IBM and another one from Eurtech, if I remember well, for monitoring an oil pipe in the desert. So they had to use satellite communication to monitor this system, and they came up with this very, very lightweight protocol to avoid wasting money in the setup. So the first public release was done in 2010 with the version MQTT 3.1. In 2014, it became an OSI standard, then an ISO standard. A few months before, they started the process for releasing MQTT 5 as a standard, and this process ended in last year in March. So this MQTT is an application level protocol. So going back to this one, it stays somewhere in here if we refer to the TCP IP model, but it stays up here in the ISO-OSI conceptual model of a communication protocol. This standard, here I forgot to insert a slide about the resources. This presentation is based mainly on the open documentation, OSIS documentation of MQTT. 3.1.1 and 5.0, but other very useful guide and documentation are here in Design Spark, MQTT 2, and this other one, IVMQ, is very, very detailed and deep documentation about the MQTT protocol. And they recently, they are releasing other blog posts about the MQTT 5 protocol, so the most recent the most recent version. So going back in here, the specification doesn't require a specific transport layer. In the documentation, it's reported that MQTT requires a transport layer that provides an ordered, lossless, bidirectional stream of bytes. So, as a non-normative comment in the documentation, is reported that TCP/IP, WebSocket, and TLS can be used. So, again, just to stress this concept, TLS is kind of referred as a transport layer on which MQTT protocol can be implemented, but as we have seen before, is not strictly a transport layer, is somewhere above the transport layer, because TLS, SSL are based on TCP/IP. But these three transport layers aren't mandatory. So any transport layer that provides these features can be used to implement an MQTT communication system without breaking the specification, the standard. So in the MQTT protocol, communication protocol, we have two different entities. One is the client. Better, in an MQTT system, there will be a lot of clients, and one server or a broker. So each client can publish application messages. These application messages are the information that each client want to send to other clients that might be interested in. So a client can subscribe to the broker to request application messages, can unsubscribe, so to stop getting messages from a server or a broker, can disconnect the server. On the other side, the server accept connection from clients, can accept the messages published by the clients and forward the application, this application message to other clients which have already requested to the server to be subscribed to a specific message. So MQTT decouples the communication between clients, putting a broker, a server, in the middle. This is a standard pattern in IT technology that is called just publication. Publish subscribe pattern. So if a specific client want to send other information to another client, it just communicate with the broker, and the broker will forward the messages to other clients. The messages are categorized in classes. These classes can be defined as are defined in the standard as topics. And they are just the string labels, and the publishing and subscribing process rely on these labels to detect which clients are interested in specific classes or topics. So the broker performs a filtering in the forwarding process based on the topic. And this kind of architecture grant an higher scalability and topology of the network, because there is no need in changing the architecture when adding client or when when other entities need to be part of a bigger system, but somehow puts some constraint in the data structure of the application messages that are sent and received by the clients. Because if it's needed to make a change in the data structure, all the clients that publish in the specific topic, on all the clients that receive messages on a specific topic, should be changed accordingly. So here on the right there is a simple scheme on how this pattern works. So there is a client that can publish messages directly to the broker without knowing if there are other clients that are receiving these messages. So if a feedback is needed to let each client know if the message has been received by the clients, this business logic should be built above the MQTT communication protocol. So it's up to the developer, to the application, to handle this kind of feedbacks. So when a client can publish to the broker, whenever another client subscribes to the same topic on which the first client publishes messages, then the broker will forward the message also to other clients. Subscription and publication are categorized on topics. So if this client on the right subscribes to the blue topic, it won't receive the red and the black topics. It's not really like that, because we will see later how this process can really works. So in MQTT we have two kind of topics: the topic names, that are string labels on which clients can publish on, and topic filters that are used to the subscription. MQTT define a topic as a level structure. So in the string, in the label of the topics, an user may define different levels, and MQTT imposes the use of the slash to separate these levels. When publishing on a topic name, the whole topic must be written down completely. But for subscription, it's possible to use wildcards to tell the broker to forward to the client all the topic that matches, not just byte by byte, all the topic label, but for instance, a client can ask to get all the topic that match all levels apart from one level. So we have a wildcard for a single level of the topic, or that is the plus character, or the hashtag character, that is a wildcard for multiple levels. So this comment on the right are extracted from the specification. So these are non-normative comments. So inside the specification, there are not just the strict rules that one have to comply in order to implement a correct MQTT communication system, but it also provides some examples and some comments also on the implementation side. So, for example, for a subscription, this topic appears sport/tennis/plus matches both these other two because they start with the same levels, sport and tennis, and this plus will match both player one and player two. But if we add another level after the others, this other one, this topic won't match this topic name, sport, tennis, player one, ranking won't match this topic filter. Okay, these are some details. Unless there are specific questions that I'm happy to try to answer to, I will skip. So it's an invitation to everybody. If you have some questions, some clarification, just stop me. About the multi-level wildcard, it has to be put at the end of the topic. Of the topic filter, some peculiarities that, for instance, sport/hashtag matches just the topic name sport. So even if we add a level separator, a slash, and then put the hashtag, this filter matches also single level topic names. Okay, so this last topic filter down here, sport tennis hashtag ranking, is not a valid topic filter. So it's a protocol error to use this kind of filter. MQTT says that there are also some special topics that starts with the dollar symbol, and they are mainly used for statistics or for specific implementation details. And there is a single normative statement in the documentation related to this kind of special topics that say that the topic filters that starts directly with a wildcard won't match the special topics. So if a client wants to receive all the messages that flows in a MQTT system, he should subscribe both to hashtag. So hashtag is a topic filter that will match all the normal, let's say, the normal topic names, but also to dollar to a dollar and then wildcards or extended levels to receive also the special topic, the messages that are published on the special topic name.
After the dollar, you can put the single level or multiple level then?
No, because it should start with the. No. Yeah. You can. Dollar and hashtag. I honestly don't remember this, but. Dollar and hashtag should match all the other, because these are the special case, yeah, all the special topics. Otherwise, you should put the first level that is usually dollar symbol CIS / hashtag, and then you will match all the other CIS or the special topics. Yeah. MQTT provide also a parameter that is called quality of service to fine-tune the delivery of the messages. So there are three possible quality of service level, 0, 1, and 2. When publishing a message with quality of service 0, each client knows that at most that message will be delivered once. With quality of system, so it's called also fire and forget. So a client fired this message and doesn't know if this message will reach all the potential interested clients. With the quality of server, with the quality of service MQTT ensure you that at least that message will be delivered once, but it can be delivered multiple times. The same message, and with the quality of service 2, it will be delivered exactly once. On this parameter, one may think that for critical mission messages, a client should use quality of service 2, so to be sure that that message is will be delivered, but it's not always true because we will see this in with more detail later. But with quality of service 2, it's granted that that message will be published to other clients even after a disconnection or even after a huge amount of time. So when sending a message with quality of service 2, we know that that message will be delivered, but we don't know when it will be delivered. So in the Design Spark blog post, they make an example about controlling a relay in a system, and if we use a quality of service 2 message to control a relay that is in another part of the world, but in that moment, that client that is interested in receiving this message is offline, it won't receive that message, but it will receive again when it will came back online, and maybe, depending on the application, it's not a good thing that that client receive that message in a different moment.
Andrea, I have a question.
Yeah.
So is there a feedback that is sent from the client to the broker after receiving the message?
There is a flow between each client that publish a message with a specific quality of service and among the client that publish and the broker who received this publish, and for each of the clients to which that message is forwarded to, there is another exchange of messages that depends on the quality of service. So the MQTT protocol in the version 3.1.1 does not provide to the publisher a feedback that the client.
So the publisher doesn't know whether the subscriber received the message or not in real time.
Exactly. I mean, you can develop an application that provide feedbacks to the to the client, but again, it depends on the application. The MQTT 3.1.1 as it is defined in the specification, because there are a lot of different flavors of MQTT that doesn't strictly follow the OOIC standard, but as it doesn't provide the publisher feedback on when clients received the message they published.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If I remember correctly, there's only a four-way check between the broker and the receiver client to ensure that the message has been received, but the publisher
we will see the message is we will see in a few minutes. This is how these quality of service 0, 1, and 2 are carried on. With absolutely no feedback or handshake, neither between the publisher and the broker, or a single exchange with quality of service 1 or with a foreign shake.
I had a question on the message published. The publish between, there are two types of publish operation, from clients and broker, and broker clients.
Yes, it's just a single type of publishing that can be made in one way or the other.
It's the different source that publish.
Exactly.
But one time the client that publish, the second way is the broker to the client.
Exactly.
This point of service from the broker to the client, how can be set the quality of service?
So for each published message, so in this a client published to a broker specifying the quality of service for each message. Whenever a client asks a subscription to the broker, he specifies the maximum quality of service that this client is able to handle for that specific topic filter. In this case, the broker will forward to this client each message published with any quality of service on any topic that matches, on any topic name that matches the topic filters that this client has subscribed to, trying to maintain the same quality of service of the original published message. But if the subscriber subscribed with a lower quality of service for a specific topic filter, then the broker may degrade the quality of service when forwarding messages to subscribers. For instance, many MQTT broker that are available, also AWS, doesn't implement the quality of service too. Maybe also RabbitMQ. This is another story, because it's not a protocol error, but it's a feature that isn't implemented in the broker, and it may drop the connection if someone asks to using this kind of quality of service. But for the standard, the message published forwarded to other clients use the same quality of service of the original published message, unless the subscription is made with a lower max quality of service, and then the broker would downgrade the quality of service just for that client, because these two clients on the right may.
So the broker can only downgrade the quality of service in that particular case, but is not upgraded the quality of service if a message publisher is with a lower quality of service.
No, exactly.
Okay.
This is what the specification say. As we, most of all of us knows, each broker, each driver, client side or broker side, is implemented in a different way, and not every broker and not every client respect all the MQTT specification. So it's always better to check all this stuff, because one may expect that a broker works in some way because of the specification, but maybe it doesn't.
The check you're talking about is a very low level and check the single package sent through the socket, or there is another way to check these kind of things?
I'm pretty sure that there are tools that provide you ways to test this feature in automatic ways, but since each broker may implement each function in a different way, maybe yes, or you rely on the documentation of that specific broker implementation or MQTT implementation, or you, I mean, I, if I had to rely on a specific system, I prefer to check bitwise or bytewise the messages, because we are going to see this. It's pretty straightforward. It's not so difficult to do this. Okay. So quality of service. We have three levels. At most once delivery, at least once delivery can be delivered multiple times. Quality of service two, exactly one delivery. So one and only one. Quality messages published with quality of service one and two are or can be, again, depends on the implementation of the system, are stored on the broker side for persistent session with the clients. So the broker, whenever a new client connects to the broker, unless a small detail that we are going to see, it starts storing, creating a session. This session contains the client subscription, so all the topic filters and the related quality of service on which the clients, for which the clients ask for subscription, and all the unconfirmed, so the new messages that are published with quality of service greater than zero, and all the message published with the quality of service one or two, but that for which the exchange flow hasn't been completed yet. Also, the client should store the session for the second part. So also the client that want to send a message with quality of service greater than zero and expect a feedback from the broker and want to preserve the session across subsequent connection to the broker should do some homework, so should store information as well. Another feature that is provided by MQTT, but is not strictly related to permanent session, is the retained messages. So a client, when publish a message, can tell the broker that that message has to be retained. So these messages are stored in another storage on the broker, and whenever a new client, after that publish has been completed, subscribe to a topic filter that matches the topic name on which the client published a retained message, that client that did the subscribe will receive instantly the last retained message on the topic. So just think about of a system
only the last
on that topic name. So if different clients or also the same client publish on different topics name with the flag, with the retain flag, and a single client may receive multiple messages with the related to the same subscription if the topic filters matches multiple topic names in which there are retained messages. This may be used to give a feedback to a new client about some kind of process instantly without having to wait for a new publish from other clients. This concept is used also on the last will feature. That is another feature provided by MQTT. So each client may tell the broker, may give the broker a last will and testament. So if the client drop, if the connection between the client and the broker ends unexpectedly, so without a proper exchange of messages as defined by the specification, and the client had told the broker the last will and testament, the broker will publish a last will message that is just a normal publish to other clients that are subscribed to that topic in behalf of the client that has disconnected unexpectedly. So also the last will message use a topic, a quality of service, a retain flag, and a application message, a payload as a normal publish message.
The payload is the testament.
It's the testament. It's just the payload as a normal message. As a subscriber, I mean, these are used to tell interested clients that something wrong happened or that the connection with the original client dropped in an unexpected way. But it's a simple, apart from the fact that this message is published by the broker, not after a published message from the original client, but after a disconnection event, an unexpected disconnection event, is just like a normal published message.
And this last message will be not sent if the client disconnected gracefully with the disconnect on
exactly.
Unexpected.
Only on an unexpected way. Yeah. And
so it's used to notify the broker and the other clients that that client has been disconnected. It's just like a notification.
It can be used as a notification. Yeah. If the broker doesn't provide functionalities to tell other clients or other services about the connection state.
So is it possible also to associate to keep a like message or last will some functions like callbacks to be executed when a client disconnects?
On other clients.
Okay.
So on the application level, on other clients that will receive these kind of messages.
Can activate
something, yeah. But again, it's just like a normal message. Mm-hmm. The use of this feature depends on the application. But MQTT provides you a way to notify other clients about unexpected disconnection from other clients. Keep alive, so MQTT provides you a way you can...
Sorry, Andrea, the retain mechanism in the last will message, how is...
Just like the other, just like the other retained messages. So, when a client publishes a message, a retained message, the broker will keep this message and will forward that message to other clients even after
the subscription.
After the subscription that happens after the publish of the
published. Okay, perfect.
The same is here. in the last will. So let's think
about that client. For that client, if, for example, he publishes another message before another retained message before, it will be substituted by the last will message.
Exactly. So Giacomo told me that he met the one of the two guys that implemented MQTT, the one from IBM, and he told Giacomo that he had to think about a birth message, so the opposite of last message. So
okay.
And so to think about a way for the clients to tell everybody that he's connected. This feature can be implemented, of course, in the business logic that use MQTT. So you may think of a client that whenever it connects to the broker sends a publish on the same topic of the last will with the retain flag with the quality of service that you want to. So to notify everyone that in that moment is connected. But of course, whenever it disconnect unexpectedly, the broker will fire this last will message. So this one will overwrite the birth message.
If you publish the birth message on a different topic with respect to the last
week, you will have always the birth message in the topic and the last will message in the last will topic, and you don't know unless you change the payload with something with, I don't know, the timestamp, but you won't know which is the correct information. Another feature, feature that the MQTT protocol provides is the keep alive interval and the ping mechanism. So each client, when connecting to the broker, may define a keep alive interval. And that impose a time interval between outbound messages, after which, if the broker doesn't receive any message, will drop the connection. We will drop the connection. This seems that it has been implemented to avoid to address half open connection issues on TCP/IP. So whenever the connection drops, but one of the two entities on the connection doesn't get that the connection has dropped, they may think that the other entity is still there, but with the keep alive, so with the ping pong mechanism, they may find that the connection has dropped. On the application level, also TCP IP sockets, for example, provide this kind of feature with the keep alive parameters. This is in the application level. MQTT 3.1.1 provide also an authentication method with just username and password, but all the packets are in clear. So MQTT doesn't provide any encryption system or encryption method inside the protocol as it is. So this is why it's always better to rely on a TLS SSL connection to provide cybersecurity to the system. Control messages. So each protocol data unit that is exchanged between the entities, so between the clients and the broker, are called control messages. And all of these control messages are composed of three parts. One is the first one is the fixed, it is the fixed header that is always present in all the control messages. And this small header contains just the control message type, because MQTT defines a few control message type, and the length of the total message, at least it's the length of the variable header and the payload part of the control message. We will see this in a few seconds. Also, the MQTT 5, as we will see, use the same structure, but we'll introduce a few changes, a few very interesting changes. So, connection. The connection is started from a client. So the broker is there somewhere. A client can establish a network connection, TLS, SSL, WebSocket, with whatever it is. So a connection with the broker. Then it have to send a connect control message to the broker. So this one is the first packet sent by the client to the broker. If the client sends something else, the broker may close the connection without telling the client why. So the broker can close the connection. If the client sends a malformed packet, if that specific client is unauthorized to connect, and if the client sends two times a connect message to the broker, so after a connection procedure has been completed, if the client sends another connect, the broker may, should, or shall close the connection. Or the specification say even other clients connect with the same client ID. So,
we know a lot about this.
Yeah, we all know. We all know. So the if you are lucky, the broker drops the connection, close the connection after sending a connect. So after sending an acknowledgement to the client. But even if the MQTT specification tells us that the broker should provide a connect, not always in real implementation this is performed. For a successful connection, the client sends a connect control message to the broker reply with a connect, and from this moment on, the two can interact in other ways. So again, the connect in MQTT 3.1.1 is the first message that the broker must send back to the client, and it contains some useful information, potentially useful information from the client. So this is the structure of the connect message. So this is it's composed of the three parts that we saw before: the fixed header, the variable header, and the payload. Up here there is the length in bytes of each piece of each segment of each of the three parts, and here below the name of these parts. So in the fixed header and for the connect data unit, the first segment of the fixed header is fixed, just contains the control packet type that for the connect is the decimal one number, and a few reserved bits that have to be set to zero. the packet length. MQTT use this kind of representation of a variable length number that contains the message of the contain the length of the variable header and payload part of the message. So in each control packet in the fixed header, the second element, so starting from the second element and at maximum at the fifth byte, there is represented the length of the variable header and the payload part of the message. And here, this table is extracted from the specification, so from numbers, from at maximum, they use 4 bytes. In each byte, the most significant bit is the continuation bit. Whenever it sets, it tells the parser who parse this message that the another byte will follow that together with the previous one represent the total length. So and from this table we may detect that at maximum the variable header plus the payload may contain 268,000 bytes. So this is the maximum message length, but it also includes the variable header. And for example, for the publish, we will see that there it's contained the topic and other stuff. Protocol name. Protocol name is fixed and is composed of 6 bytes in UTF-8 encoding. In whenever an UTF-8 string is required as a parameter for a segment of a message, it starts with two bytes in big endian, representing the length of the following string, and then the actual values of the string represented in UTF-8 encoding. So for the connect message, this segment in the variable header contains as the first 2 bytes 0, 4. This means that it will follow a 4-byte length UTF-8 encoded string. And it contains MQTT. So this is the ASCII, the UTF-8 values related to the charters MQTT. Protocol level. Protocol level is the following segment. Of the protocol name, it is 1 byte long and it contains the number 4. Number 4 is related to MQTT 3.1.1. The MQTT 3.1 was the version 3. MQTT 5 will contain the byte 5, and this is why there is no 4, because the MQTT 4 is MQTT 3.1.1. Flags. So whenever a client connects to the broker, it will encode in the message some flags. For example, the presence or the absence of the username and password used for trivial authentication. A few flags and few parameters for the last will and testament feature. And a bit for a clean session and a reserved bit. So these 4 bits are used to tell the broker if a will message will be present in the payload of this connect message. Also the quality of service. So whenever will flag is set to it is set, so if the bit 2 is set, also these other three bits will be parsed by the broker. The broker may disconnect the client without letting him know why, if the will flag is clear, but these three are set. So if you tell the broker that you won't put a will flag, but you, if you set the will retain the quality of service bits, yeah, it may drop the connection because it considers a protocol error, a malformed packet. Clean session, so in related to the permanent sessions, whenever the client connects to the broker, can tell the broker to clean any previous session held by the broker. So whenever the client sets this bit, the session held by the broker will be clean. And I remember the session contains previous subscription and quality of service, one or two messages or uncompleted, unfinished messages. If the client connects with the clean session set, bit set, not only the broker will clear the session for that client, but after the connection disconnect in a graceful or ungraceful way, it won't store a session for that client. So if you want to clear the current session, but you want to be sure that the broker keep a session after your disconnection, you have to connect with a clear session, then disconnect and connect again with a clear session equal to zero. Otherwise, the broker will maintain the session just for the connection time, but after the disconnection, it won't store any data. Again, this is what the specification says.
Connect and disconnect the first time and then connect the
other. Yeah. And this is why in the MQTT 5 they changed this bit. Instead of clean session, they called it clean start. So the clean start bit. So if the client directly can tell to the broker to clear the session, but to keep a session after its disconnection, just to avoid this connection disconnection to clear the session. The other two bytes contain the keep alive interval, so it's represented as an integer in a two byte integer in Big Endian, and it may be equal to zero. In that case, there is no keep alive interval, so the broker won't disconnect the client even if it doesn't send any message to the broker. Okay, so when it connects, the client specifies this keep alive, but for the specification, the broker use 1.5 times the keep alive value to count the time. So if here the client write 10 seconds, the broker will wait 1.5 times 10 seconds, that is 15 seconds. Client ID. Client ID is contained in the payload, is a mandatory field, and the specification say that any broker shall accept client ID UTF-8 encoded strings with length from 1 to 23 bytes, but some broker may accept also 0 character. So this is required. Every broker must accept 1 to 23 length client ID, but this is tolerated. Again, as we've seen before, the client ID is represented as an UTF-8 encoded strings. It uses 2 bytes to tell how long is the client ID and then the client. So there's a variable part of the message that is related to the last will and testament that is optional. Is optional in sense that if the will flag in here is clear, this shouldn't be present. So both the will topic and the will message. So the will topic is encoded as an UTF-8 string. Its length have to be greater than one, equal or greater than one. So it's not possible to publish on zero length topics. The payload may be, so the payload, the message of the will, so the testament, may be zero length, and there is no standard codification for the data, so it's just bytes. It's up to you to decide the encoding or the message type. In any case, it is required to specify the length of the message. Last two parameters of the connect message are username and password, and the username is UTF-8 encoded string. The password may be any codification. So the authentication method, even if it's not reliable, because it's all the message flows in clear, may require just the username or the username and password. In MQTT5, it's also possible to continue the authentication process with just the password without the username. In MQTT 311 is a protocol error.
So, sorry, Andre. Ma this is the example for the connect message. So there is no payload, the real payload.
So the fixed header, variable header, and payload are just the names in MQTT specification that compose a whole message, any message. In this case, so for the connect message, the payload will contain, in this order, the client ID.
Yeah. So there is no real payload in the message.
There is if you use a will, if you set the will.
It is for the will message, not for the normal message. Normal message is not present for the connect.
Normal message is another message type that is the published message that we will see.
Okay.
No. So the broker may reply with a connect that is shorter, so it just has the fixed header and the variable header. There is no payload in this message type. It contains again the control packet. The control packet type, that is the number 2, reserved bits. The length here is fixed because the variable, we will have only a 2-byte length variable header. In the first byte in the variable header, we will hold acknowledgement flags. And in this case, there is just one flag, that is the session present. So whenever the client connects and the broker replies to the client with a connect, it can tell the client if there is a session present on the broker. And if the client connects with the clean session flag set, the broker will reply with SP cleared, because there is no session whenever the clients connect to the broker with a clean session. If the clean session flag is clear, so the clients connects preserving the session, SP, so this bit may be set or clear depending on the status of the server. For that client ID, so the session is related to a client ID. So since the client ID is required, is another details. A zero length client ID is accepted. In that case, no session will be stored for that client ID. And if a client connects with a zero length client ID and a clean session cleared, bit cleared, it is considered a protocol error and the broker may drop the connection. It's always funny to get dropped connection without knowing why. So there is just a single flag about the presence of the session on the broker side, and if you are lucky, you get a return code. For a successful connection, the return code, so it's a single byte return code, is zero. For these other four condition, they specified some return code. The specification say that if the broker reject the connection for any reason outside these four, it should drop the connection without sending the connection. No, maybe it's not clear. Is connection refused an acceptable protocol version? So the protocol version part of the in the variable header of the connect is wrong, or the client ID, the server may avoid a connection for a client, or if the server is unavailable, or the credential for the authentication are wrong, or the client is unauthorized by the connect, by the broker. Publication. Publication, it can be sent both by the client and by the broker. So whenever a broker forward a message to other clients or sends the last will messages, the broker do a publish, send a publish message. Also in this case, the connection can be dropped by the broker or by the client if there are some malformed topic, or the client is unauthorized to publish, or the quality of service is not 0, 1, or 2. So we have 2 bits. If we set both bits, it considers as a malformed topic and it may drop the connection. Or there is no topic in message. So if it's not possible to use zero length by the standard zero length topic messages. For quality of service 0, the client or the broker just fire a publish and that's it. For quality of service 1, the receiver of the publish have to send back a pub back message, and the client or the broker should send again the publish and with the quality of service 1 until it get back a pub back message. It should not do this during the same session, but maybe in the following session. So if a client want to publish a quality of service 1 message and it didn't receive a pub back, and it want to store the session, if it disconnects and connects again, it should keep in memory this publish with the same information to send back to the broker. And for quality of service 1 and 2, we will see in the following slide, there is a flag, a duplicate flag, just to tell the receiver that it may be a duplicate message, because maybe the other entity, the receiver received the publish, send the pub back, but is the pub back that is lost somewhere. So just to be sure that just to tag the message as a duplicate, we use the duplicate flag. And the message contain a packet identifier to keep track of all the messages. In the quality of service 2, there is a for way and shake. And apart from the publish, there are used other 3 message types. Publish received is kind of a payback from the broker, but there is again another publish release and publish complete exchange. Also in this case, for permanent session, the client or the broker, so the one who do the publish and also the one who receive the publish, should keep in memory information about this flow for each of the messages exchanged in this way. So the who do the publish will publish again the message across different session until it doesn't receive a pub rec. Whenever it receives a pub rec, it knows that the other entity received that message. So who did the publish may discard the original message, but just keep track of the identifier. So to start another process of these 2 messages, pub rel and pub comp, to be sure that if in the previous exchanges the message has been published multiple times, anyhow it will be considered just a single message. So here there is also a duplicate message, and there is a double exchange to avoid sending multiple times the publish without receiving back the pubback. And telling the receiver that these are different messages, because MQTT define a duplicate flag for quality of service 1 and 2, but are used just in quality of service 2. So even if there is a packet identifier in the message, the packet identifier may be reused after a complete transfer. So whenever a client publish a message, the receiver received that, send back a pubback. The moment the receiver sent back the pubback, the client, the packet identifier identified used for this message can be reused for a new message. So it's okay if the client send another published message with the same packet ID. It's tolerated by the, it's okay for the specification. But if the client sends again another publish with the same packet ID, not just because it wants, but just because it haven't received the pubback, the receiver won't check the duplicate flag. So it may be considered as a new message. And this is why with the quality of service 1, it's granted that the message is sent at least 1, but it may be sent, so it's interpreted as a new message multiple times, even if exactly the same content. With the quality of service 2, we use these 2 other messages to complete the transfer message, the transfer process for the same packet identifier. The publish message is made of the same 3 parts. We have the control packet, And in this case, the reserved bits for the previous control packets are used for telling the receiver that the message is a duplicate or not, so specifying the quality of service for that message, and to tell the receiver that that message is being, it should be retained or not. So the duplicate flag is always zero for publish with quality of service zero and for first attempt of delivery of each message. It's set to, it is set, so it's equal to one for attempts of re-deliver. This flag isn't propagated direct to subscribers. But whenever the broker receives a publish, and then the broker has to forward that message to other clients, it will start another process of publication with each of the subscriber clients. So in the original publish message from clients to broker, they use a duplicate flag, but just for exchange between that client and the broker. For each of the forwarding process, they will start again. They will start again from clear duplicate flag, and will handle with each client a transmit procedure.
It's only used from the client to the broker
and to the broker to from the clients, but in a separate way. Mm. So it's again is used this bit when the broker publish to client, but is not the broker start from scratch with the duplicate. So the first time the broker send a subscriber a message, he will set the duplicate flag to zero, and then if he doesn't receive the pullback of the pull break, we send again that message setting the flag. I mean,
and how the subscriber can know that?
Because it's exactly the same process, but it's a different process. Because since the MQTT decouples the publication to the subscription, it's the broker that handles the forwarding to the other client. Mm. So for each of the subscriber clients, it starts a new, with the same content, with the same payload on that topic, on that with another packet identifier. So the packet identifier, we will see. Okay, the packet identifier is different. Both from client and broker, and also for other clients.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. And this duplicate flag usually is handled by the drivers, not at the application level, but at the driver level. It may be so. Since the fact that the duplicate flag isn't propagated to subscribers, it's related to the fact that with publication made with quality of service one may be delivered more than once. Because if a client publishes multiple times the same message, but it doesn't receive the pub back, then it crosses the connection, connect again with the clean, with maintaining the session, publish again, but it was the same message, even if it's sent with the duplicate flag, for quality of service one isn't used. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's used by the client, but it's not parsed by the broker. The specification tells that the broker may it's not obligated to parse the duplicate flag for the quality of service one. It should handle the fallback, but it's not used. Because of the way the packet identifier is handled too. So these other two bits contain the quality of service, as we said before, it may be downgraded when forwarded to subscribers, if a subscriber subscribed to a matching topic with a lower quality of service, and the retain flag. So the retain flag, in the case the published message is performed by a client, and the client send a retain bit set, the broker will retain that message unless it sends a zero length payload. In that, this is a way to clear the retained message for a specific topic. Sending a retain message with no payload. Whenever the publish is carried on by the broker to a client, this retain flag is used to tell the client if that client is receiving that message because of a subscription, so is receiving a retain message, a message that was in the storage of the broker, or it received that message because of a publication of another client live. If a client perform a publish with the retain flag clear, the broker will not retain the message nor delete the storage of the in the retained queue messages. Again, there is the packet length, the topic name. So in the variable header, there is the topic name on which the message has to be published and must not contain wildcards. So it's just a topic name. And there is no details in the specification, so it depends on the implementation of the broker. But if a client make different subscription that overlaps, so with a single level or multiple level, it may receive the same message multiple times. It may. So in the variable header, there is also the packet identifier that is used in the control flow for quality of service 1 and 2, and this option. So this 2-byte packet identifier won't be in the message, in the published message with quality of service equal to 0. It can't be equal to 0 whenever it is there. And the same, so the identification of the messages are shared across different packet types, but the client and the broker may assign the identifier in their flow, in their exchange, independently. So a packet identifier 1 sent by the client to the broker isn't the same message with the packet identifier 1 sent by the broker towards the same client. And the values can be reused after acknowledgement. So if I send a published message with the quality of service greater than 0 with a specific packet identifier, the publisher may reuse the same package identifier after it received the acknowledgement. And this is the payload of the published message. So it is the application message. It can be zero. There is no content type for this payload. So it's just raw bytes. Maybe a JSON string, a binary, data, whatever it is. And the max length of the payload is given by the difference between the max packet length, it is 268,000 bytes, less the variable header length. So if you use a very long topic, you may lose 60K of payload. Of payload size. PubAC, PubRec, PubRel, and PubComp are quite similar. They have different control packet numbers with the same length, packet identifier. So the PubAC message contains in the variable header the same packet identifier of published packet with quality of service 1. For quality of service 2, we have PubRec with a different control packet, same packet length, and in this case it contains in the variable header the packet identifier of the published message with quality of service 2. Then the PubRel that is sent by the original publisher and contains the identifier of the PubRec, so the previous of the step 1 out of 3 message that is the same as the publish. So publish sends a packet identifier. The receiver sends back a PubAC with the same packet identifier. At that point, the publisher may discard the message and just keep the PubRec and send back a PubRel. There are a few messages in which the reserved bits the bit 1 is set for the subscribe and unsubscribe too. I don't know why, but I haven't got grasped the meaning behind this bit. Packet length, packet identifier, pack comp again as the other part. Subscription, so how the client can tell the broker that he wants to receive specific messages with subscribe control type message. The subscribe can be sent only by the client to the broker, and the broker, as always, may drop the connection if something is upsetting. So, wrong reserved bits, no topic filtering message, malformed topic, and so on.
In all this situation, the last request provided will be sent. If you subscribe in all this situation, well, then close the connection because there is something wrong. They will, testament will be sent.
I don't know, maybe yes, I haven't read anything about this, but because it's strange, because in this case, the broker, I mean, I will search this. I will search this. Yeah. I haven't found any references in the specifications. Well,
logically, can be seen as a broken connection. It's not normally closed at the client.
But it's an actual action performed by the broker. It's not a reliable connection.
The broker closed the
connection. It's the broker that closed the connection. So Maybe not, but I'm not sure. The specification says that in the process of subscription, whenever it's successful, the broker may start publishing messages matching the subscribe request before sending the acknowledgement to the client.
We subscribe with quality of service greeting.
With
quality of service greater than zero.
With any quality of service. So if a client, it may happen that a client subscribe to a topic filter, and the broker, even before sending the acknowledgement of the subscribe to the client, may start publishing messages back to the client for on topic names that match the topic filter. Okay.
Always, it depends.
Yeah, but in this case, the specification tells that it may happen. So it depends on the implementation, but it is not a protocol error or an infringement of the specification. The specification say that this kind of situation may happen. So it's compliant with the specification. Of course, it depends on the implementation of the broker. So the subscribe message is as the control packet type 8. Have this bit set in the reserver bits. The packet length with the same representation of the total length. The packet identifier is as the same use of the publish messages. Then in the payload, we have 2 bytes that tells the length of the topic. Then the topic that has to be at least 1 character long, 1 byte long, and then a byte containing the quality of service. A single topic filter is mandatory, is required, otherwise it's an infringement of the specification. In a single subscribe message, multiple topic filters may be sent. So with a single message, a client may perform multiple subscription on different topic filters with different quality of service. So for the publish, the quality of service of the published messages are encoded in the variable in the first byte of the fixed header. In the subscribe, they use a single whole byte to hold just 2-bit information. And all these other bits are reserved, and they should be all clear.
If I don't remember wrong, our implementation MQTT Python can be send a subscribe message with multiple topics. And in the PAO, just one message for one topic for the subscription.
It may be. So the specification, the MQTT specification, told us that it's okay to send a subscribe control packet with multiple topic filters, but you are not forced to.
Yeah.
You can't use the same topic filter on the same payload because it considers a protocol error, but you can send a subscribe message multiple times with the same topic filter because maybe you want to change the quality of service.
Okay.
The broker, so you can send up to N, and N depends on the maximum length of the message. You may send N up to N topic filter for subscription. The subex, so the acknowledgement that the broker sends back to the client with in response to a subscription, contain another control packet type, the same length, a packet identifier that is the same of the subscribed packet, and then a series of bytes contain the return code for each topic filter in the subscribe message with the same order. So the broker may reject a subscription to a specific topic. So the broker may have rules to allow or disallow the subscription to a specific topic, maybe depending on the client ID and so on. In that case, instead of dropping the connection, it should send back an acknowledgement with a failure. For instance, I'm not sure if we handle this in both in the Python the Python MQTT library. I don't think so.
As always, it depends.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, this it may be a useful feedback also for the business logic application, because if you want to perform some subscription, you expect to receive message on a specific topic, but the broker tells you that you can't, or he didn't manage to register the subscription. Maybe useful to provide a feedback.
But yeah, and also to handle the feedback.
Exactly. Same process for unsubscription. So the client send a specific message to the broker to tell the broker to not send any more message. Again, it can close the connection if something is wrong. In this case, in the same way, in the specification is told that the broker may start sending publish before sending the acknowledgement. For the unsubscription, the broker may continue send this publishes after sending the unsubscription acknowledgement to the client. If, for example, the broker had some other message in his internal queues or other stuff. Even in this case, the unsubscribe message can contain multiple topic filters. So we have a very similar structure, but in this case, in the payload, we won't have any quality of service byte, because for the unsubscription, the broker will match byte by byte the topic filter from the topic filter list for that client ID and what it will unmatch. In this case, the broker will send back an unsubscribe acknowledgement, but he won't tell the client if the broker managed to perform that subscribe. So there is no feedback about this. Ping rec, ping resp. So for the ping process to stay inside the keep alive interval, the client may send. So it's up to the client to check the connection and to keep alive the connection, sending ping rec. If the broker send the ping resp, the keep alive timer, let's say it's resetted, but if the client doesn't receive back the ping rest, it should close the connection, because it may assume that the underlying transport layer is faced with some problems. So these two messages are exchanged if the keep alive integer sent in the connect message from the client is different from zero.
Because the interval of the ping rec
is up to the client. Because if a client send always messages that checks also the bidirectional message, so if it receives acknowledgement, and these message exchange are faster than the time interval, it may also not send the ping request.
But it's up to the
implementation. It's up to the implementation. It's generally handled by the drivers, not at the application level. So it's the driver that keep track of which messages, of the outbound and inbound messages, and fire ping rec to be sure that underlying connection is still working properly. Ping rest and ping rec are very little messages, just 2 bytes, just a fixed header, and the same with the with the ping rest. This connection, so the client may send a message to the broker to perform a graceful disconnection. So after which the broker may clean the session or keep the session. And so on. Also the disconnect is just two bytes, and there is no acknowledgement for this. Okay, so what's new in the MQTT 5? The main changes were made on performance, scalability, and error reporting. It's already an OASIS standard. It's not an ISO standard yet. So they changed a little bit the existing functionality. So the sessions, there is the broker may hold a session, but if the clients want to clear the session but keep a session after it disconnects, it don't have any more to connect and disconnect again, setting and clearing the flag. They added a parameter in the last wheel because they inserted a last wheel delay. They cleaned a little bit the procedures for message retransmission for quality of service 1 and 2, and they changed a little bit the disconnection. They added a new packet type, the 15, the last remaining in a single 4-bit data, is related to authentication, so it's not any more trivial, just like the previous one, but it's still maybe still better to rely on TLS and SSL connection. All these new features are summarized in the Appendix C of the documentation. In the specification, so just at the end, we will have a list of, so it's a non-normative, it's just a summary of the main new feature. A very interesting feature is that the variable header may contain properties that are defined as a key value pairs, just like HTTP headers. So the identifier or the key are fixed, and for each identifier they specify the value or the value format. So it's possible to, so these properties may contain metadata, for instance, the format of the payload. So it just tell other subscribers that receives messages, which is the format of the payload message. So instead of trying different unmarshal process, okay, let's see if it's comply with the JSON, and I try to perform a JSON load or a message pack or a CBOR or what else, this information may include it in the variable header of the published message. There is a topic aliases, so instead of writing the whole topic name in the published message, or the topic filter in the published subscribe, or the topic name in the published carried on by the from the broker to the clients, it's possible to define aliases. So the first time you publish a specific topic, you can use these properties to tell the broker to use an integer, a single byte or a two-byte integer, instead of the whole topic name, so you can save bytes in traffic, and from the subsequent publish on, the client or the publisher may use that integer instead of the whole
broker that maps
is the broker
for the integer to be
exactly
you can say that to 65 kilobytes,
so it's to is to see, sì, yeah.
You can say the up to this.
Yeah.
So yeah. The bytes you don't use to write topic, you can use them to the payload, maybe. Or
what?
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to think about application where you really need that 65 kilobytes, because you have to use a very huge, a very long topic name, and yes, you are fighting with bits. But again, if these procedures allow you to use multi-level topics with very huge very huge topics with a lot of levels, so very long topics without using so much bytes, so for GSM connection or for some kind of connection.
It's also valid with wildcards, so you can associate the wildcards
for the topic filters too, because we are, this is for the topic names.
Okay.
But a similar process, if I remember well, can be used for the subscription.
Sorry, I lost you. I lost you when you saying that we can save bytes in the message.
So the topic aliases, instead of sending the whole topic name, you may tell the broker that from that point in time on, you will use a specific int 2-byte integer instead of the whole topic name. And another property is related to the sessions and to the retain messages. This is an expiry interval. So when publishing a retain message or when setting a session, the client may specify an expiring interval after which the broker will discard the session or the retain message. One of these properties, so one identifier, is related to user properties, and in this case the value is a string pair value. So in the variable header you can include how many user properties you want, and each user properties has its own key and value, but in this case you have to use UTF-8 encoded strings. MQTT 5 provides way more information about error reporting and handling, they added reason codes both for clients and from and broker. They added negative acknowledgement, so even for unsuccessful operation, each entities may know why, so it gets some feedback. They use another, they introduce another property, so the one as we see, we were talking before, it is that are reason strings, so they are UTF-8 encoded human readable strings that are mainly used for debugging, or not for the application, but just for understanding what is happening. So for each of these of the messages, you can add not for all, but for a few, you can add a reason string, including some potentially useful information to study the network, to study the process, to understand better the implementation. And also in the connect message, the broker can tell the client which are the features it supports, instead of dropping the connection or just accepting the connection without letting know the client if, for instance, the quality of service 2 isn't implemented, and so on. Related to scalability, MQTT Fi introduced the shared subscription. So it's possible for a group of clients to share a subscription in the sense that all of these different clients are considered as a single client for a specific subscription. So the broker, instead of sending all of these clients every time the same message, it sends a client to just one client in a round robin fashion. So if you have a set, for instance, the ingestion service, just forget about AMQP queues. Just think about an MQTT based application. You want to develop a service that gets all the message to store it or to process it. Instead of having multiple clients that receive all the message, you can have multiple instances of a same client that share a subscription, and you are sure that just one of these clients receive a specific message, just to balance the load and to allow scalability. And there is also a request, they introduce a feature that allow at the application level to perform request-response pattern, so to ease the communication or the exchange of messages between clients. So in the connect or in the publish messages, it's possible to use two different properties, the response topic and correlation data, that are forwarded to the subscribers and tells them, for instance, or some add some metadata, so the correlation data is some binary data that is strictly related to the specific message that the original publisher sent, or the response topic that is, for instance, contains the topic where a client may respond a request on a different topic. So think about jobs in the IBM. We hard coded the topics on which clients and brokers exchange messages for the RPC and this kind of stuff. But MQTT 5 provides way to automatically or to is the exchanges of messages in a request response. So the jobs or the RPC in the ZDM are implemented from the broker to the clients. But this kind of feature allow you to ease you in the process of developing an application where two clients trigger action one to the other.
But so we we can compare these things to the HTTP request, so there is no more
no because even the response isn't in the acknowledgement, for instance, but okay. It tells the final subscriber where to expect some.
But in low level specification, there is always a WebSocket always open.
You mean in the MQTT 5?
Yeah.
It relies on the same network connection, so it doesn't specify. I think it doesn't specify the specific transport layer, but it requires a bidirectional lossless.
Okay, because I'm confused because I see request response, connect and publish. So
no, these are two properties used in the connect and publish messages.
Ah, okay, sorry.
Connect one, yeah, is related to the last will message, and the publish to RPC or request response application implementation. So in this case, the specification tell us how all the single messages are composed. They introduced also a few data types in the specification. For instance, the string pairs of 4-byte integers, a lot of other stuff, but I didn't have the I didn't want to to force you to look at all the bits also for MQTT 5. That's it.
I have a general question. The last one. In your opinion, what is the feature offered by MQTT 5 that can be used in the ZDM and can in some way help us to provide the best feature that you see, that you have seen in MQTT
5? I just say, let's start with the MQTT 3.1 features. Last will and testament may be useful just to have a way to protect to get status of the connection of the clients without relying on specific broker implementation. So it's the protocol itself that provides you a way to detect the connection, the online status of a client without interacting with the broker. So this may be used. Retain messages. I mean, it's hard to think about this because MQTT provide you a way to make different clients interact directly through the broker. And for the application that we develop, it's not always used this feature. So that's it. Maybe the properties, the use of the properties may be interesting because now we are encoding in the topic the data format. We start our with J/. It's not in MQTT 5, we can use the payload format, for instance, just to tell the receiver that the payload has to be, is intended to be parsed by a JSON parser or something else. The session management, because I don't know if we're going, I don't know if the ZDM implements the clean session or stalls the sessions, but instead of subscribing each time to the same topic, because that client will subscribe always on the same topic. It may save a few bytes each time.
So this session,
it's clearly session protocols. And I don't think that for a edge on the edge side, the shared subscription may be useful. I don't know. I haven't think about this. It can be interesting to explore the request response pattern to implement some kind of RPC, also directly from broker to connect. So, using the protocol and not building on the protocol, other logic. But this is related to MQTT5. So for the message queues on the services, I don't know how this can be integrated in the old system. And in general, error reporting, but it's a feature that provides the MQTT5 protocol on the 3.1.1. Even for the connection, we rely on TLS connection, so it's under the MQTT5. If the backend because of the TLS of the certificates or the keys, this interaction happens before the connect message. It happens on publishing TLS connection, so it's not a feature of MQTT.